And we're back. Sorry that took so long. Some real life things caught up with me. But anyway, here we are. You know, I really don't remember the Darkest Dungeon. Oh, it hits both of them. Being this easy. Oh no, it doesn't hit both of them. Okay, well, dumb mistake on my part. But like, there's healing, and it's effective now. And like, I always hit with what seems to be a 100% chance. And like I said, I really don't remember that sort of thing happening. Which is odd. Well, I'm just going to roll with it. Wait, oh, right. I can't attack with him because I just attacked with him. So I might as well break free from being stunned. Makes sense. Hey, don't hit my priesty, man. I need him for the heals. Lol. This is a goblin shaman. That's an odd typing, too. I don't remember goblins being in the Darkest Dungeon. Mostly it's like eldritch horrors and the undead. Magic missile. That is a lot of damage. Oh, okay. Yay! Let's assign attributes. His leveling up is great. His range damage is a little bit better. Or no, wait, that's not how that works. Weapon just change and melee damage. Eight. I don't remember that. Am I there? Get two. Yeah, no, I'm beginning to suspect that this isn't Darkest Dungeon at all. I think I may be mistaken here. Hang on. I'm gonna cut the stream for a bit. Get this. Whoa. And get this sorted out. And we're back. There we go. This is... Oh, I didn't mean to skip the cutscene. Hang on. While I'm talking. Alright, but this is definitely the Dankest Dungeon. No mistakes about it. I didn't mean to skip the cutscene. Sec. Those of you who've never seen the game before, I want you to catch that. All jokes aside, though, I'm poking fun at myself. I'm always like, oh, I gotta cut the stream to figure this out. Technical difficulties. And secondly, Pixel Heroes, Bite and Magic is what I was playing before. It is a fun little game, but it's not Dankest Dungeon. Ruin has come to our now continuing with the regular broadcast, all jokes aside. You remember and yeah, I am. House. Yeah. Oh, y'all, apologies for being out so long. I said I was going to go get something to eat and then disappeared for like 9 hours. Real life caught up with me once again. It's just how it is.
By decadence and luxury. And yet I began to tire of conventional extravagance.
Decadence and luxury, if you know what I mean.
Itself was a gateway to some fabulous and unnameable power. With relic and ritual, I bent every effort towards the excavation and recovery of those long buried secrets. Exhausting what remained of our family fortune, swarthy workmen and sturdy shovels. dust in the salt-soaked crags beneath the lowest foundations, we unearth that damnable portal of antediluvian evil. Our every step unsettled the ancient earth. But we were in a realm of death and madness. In the end, I alone fled laughing and wailing through those blackened arcades of antiquity. Until consciousness failed me. You remember our venerable house? Opulent and imperial. It is a festering abomination. I beg you, return home, claim your birthright, and deliver our family from the ravenous clutching shadows of the darkest dungeon.
All right, that's the darkest dungeon. Cool explanation right there. I should have read that too. Okay, one sec, guys. Sorry. Oh, there's an option in the game for watch intro cinematic. Didn't have to restart. Hey, it gets an interesting little narrative there that gives you the whole prologue to the game. There's a little prologue for you to play through as well, but it's just really teaching the basics and it's very short. I'll get to that in a minute. But yeah, the narrative goes over the overarching story, which is basically like your relative, like, has left you his mansion because it's been overrun with horrible things. Great, thanks. Bags, what? Darkest Dungeon is about making the most bad situation. That's the real theme of this game. It's in the gameplay, it's in the mechanics, it's in every little bit of it. It's, saturated with. Whoa, I was not reading the text! Sorry, I want to make a point of this because the game makes a point of telling you, and because it's just, it's a huge selling point of the game for me. It's just it. Something that I really, really enjoyed. It was an interesting idea that had me hooked from the beginning of the Kickstarter. So.
Ruin.
Nah, I don't care about ruin. Darkest Dungeon is about making the most of a bad situation. Quests will fail or must be abandoned. Heroes will die, and when they die, they stay dead. Progress autosaves constantly, so actions are permanent. The game expects a lot out of you. How far will you push your adventurers? How much are you risking your quest to restore the hamlet? What will you sacrifice to save the life of your favorite hero? Thankfully, there are always fresh souls arriving at the stagecoach, seeking both adventure and fame in the shadow of Dankest Dungeon. So basically, this little message is telling you, don't worry about it. Like, people are gonna die all the time, there'll always be new heroes to restock them. What you're essentially playing in this game is, if any of you are familiar with XCOM, you're playing XCOM on Iron Man difficulty. There is no loading saves. It constantly auto-saves for you. There will be losses. What you need to do is just focus on cutting your losses when there's a bad situation, making the most of it. So, for a long time, I have not been able to touch this game. I've not been able to play it because I don't want to play a game where I feel like I'm constantly losing all the time. But that's the game's reminder to you, the player, that you're not constantly losing. At least in the beginning, until you get like a well-established hamlet, you are going to lose people. A lot. Don't let it bother you. Nothing is permanent in the beginning of the game. Even well into the game, you might have a complete party of 4-6 heroes you could still wipe. Don't worry about it. Pick up the pieces, build yourself back up.
You will arrive along the old road. It winds with a troubling serpent-like suggestion through the corrupted countryside. Leading only, I fear, to ever more tenebrous places. There is a sickness in the ancient, pitted cobbles of the old road, and on its writhing path, you will face viciousness, violence, and perhaps other damnably transcendent terrors. So
Yeah, so again, to go into themes with despair, madness, and all that. Now. There's also this theme of redemption and perseverance, attaining your goal at whatever cost. I think this is done. But yeah, perseverance is absolutely key, but not just perseverance. Stream is crazy. Okay. Guys. Guys. I'm gonna have to restart the game. Back to probably anyhow. Yeah, I'm sorry. I don't know what happened with that. I didn't touch OBS. I didn't touch any of the graphical settings. Stream just kind of decided to do that on its own. That downscaling, that's not okay. Okay. Seems to affect all now.
Ruin has come to our.
I don't know why it suddenly spontaneously decided to like become four times smaller. Oh god, I hope that's not a bug with the. Okay, like I was saying, perseverance is definitely key in this game because there's definitely a certain mindset you need to get into, similar to XCOM, where you need to get used to disappointment. Oh my god. Why? So midstream, I'm reassigning game capture. Not working. I cannot tell you what's going on right now. I'm gonna switch it to full screen and hopefully that fixes the issue. I don't know. I really don't know, guys. This. But yeah, the attitude you need to have playing this game is that bad things are going to happen. You just need to get over it. I'm in full screen now, so if the stream is doing something weird, I can't. Let me get into past all screens. Tab. Probably. But besides perseverance, discretion is also a big part of the game. Unlike in games like XCOM, you can just abandon the quest if you need to. Just abandon the mission or whatever. And that lets you keep whatever experience and whatever treasure you have up to that point. Yeah, there we go. Things look right. I prefer keyboard controls to mouse, but some mouse controls.
brigands have run of these lanes. Keep to the side path. The hamlet is just ahead.
I don't like mouse. Yeah, I'll do that. Combat is turn-based. Click, 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 click. Yeah, a lot of the controls are just click-based. I can use the 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever keys. Hotkeys for different skills. But I don't think it's... Like you can... It's... Yeah. You can use the mouse for everything. Like, it's entirely mouse-based. But then there are certain keys that function as hotkeys as well. I don't think it's entirely dependent on the keyboard, though. Like, yeah, for example, I have no way of picking a target with the keyboard. You're going to have to blend mouse and keyboard a little bit, or just use the mouse. I prefer to blend. I have two hands, one hand on the mouse, the other hand on the keyboard. Makes sense. Although, if I just use the one hand, the mouse... Definitely take off. Then I'll have the other hand free. Yeah, Renault, I hear you. Yay! Clicking. Ooh. Hey.
Leave nothing unchecked. There is much to be found in forgotten places.
Might be going a little fast, but it's only played the tutorial before. If y'all have been paying attention, you might notice that I.
And their kind is no longer welcome.
Kind of work. Yeah. You might have noticed that I. Started a new game. Had a new file. All my files were blank. That's an illusion, a lie. I have played a bit of this game, not a lot. I checked the achievements and there's an achievement for completing 10 quests and I don't have it. Means I have played less than 10, like, dungeon dive. Every time you go into the dungeon, that is a quest.
Confidence surges as the enemy crumbles.
Corpse it. Fun time. Corpses is not fun. I'll explain that in a minute. But yeah, basically, I've played only just a bit of this game. I've just scratched the surface. I've done less than 10 dungeon dives in any one save file before giving up entirely, deleting the save, and starting a new game. Beginning. Yeah. This game is pretty frustrating for me. Let's just leave it at that. I like to start off on the right foot, like I like a good strong start, and when I don't get that, I just start over. And I need to get over that. Yeah, I've completed. But once you've got this quest complete thing, you can leave at any time. It asks you right away, do you want to continue adventure? Hamlet. If you click on continue adventuring, it tells you your quest is complete. You can leave at any time. And there's a reason I ignored that treasure chest. Okay, so corpses. At one point, in one version of the game, I guess we'll say, you could choose whether you wanted enemies to yield to produce corpses or not. Because the corpse mechanic sort of adds another layer, tactical layer to combat.
Welcome home. Such as it is.
This I'm gonna skip this. This is mostly not important. But you see on screen.
They are yours
now. It's your activity log, and the caretaker has various bosses, which sort of leads you down the right path you need to complete the main game, and then some others. Random achievement. But anyway, the corpse mechanic, it adds another layer. Okay. Adds a layer, another layer of tactics to the combat, where basically kill somebody, if you kill an enemy and it's not from bleed damage, blight damage, and those are both damage over time, status effect. For a critical hit, the enemy will produce a corpse, and then that enemy's corpse, I think, has like half the HP of the original enemy. And it blocks you. Like the enemies, your guys line up in single file. There's position, you know, one is at. So from back to front, it's position 4, 3, 2, and 1. Your guys line up, enemies line up. This is a lot easier to explain. But basically, the corpse, if there's a corpse in front, it will block you from hitting the guys in the back. Same way, living target block you from hitting the guys in the back. It only has, I think, half the health of the original enemy it came from, but it's still a nuisance. I would rather not play with it on, but there is no option to turn it off anymore. And there's an achievement for playing with the original settings. I don't want to be a casual thing. I'll just the hard way, I guess. So yeah, that's the basic strategy of combat. Is you're lined up, your guys are lined up in a certain order. The enemies are lined up in a certain order. You can't hit the back rows until you deal with the front rows. Except the front row guys also leave a corpse, so you can't really deal with the back row. Get rid of the corpses as well, unless you have a certain skill that hits the back rows, like for example Renald Sader, and his first skill might is a melee attack that will only hit the first two rows. See when I skill. This has nothing to do with the skill I'm currently looking at. I'll explain that in a minute. So you can hit the first two rows with this. This one hits both targets, or rows? Anyway, both targets in the first two positions. Again, he can only hit the targets in the first two positions. So with his current loadout, he can really only hit these two positions. That's why the game is producing this array of preferred targets. And his skills, you'll notice, also work. They only work when he's in a certain position, which is why the game this array for his preferred position. It's kind of smart that way. Other skills he can use from different locations. So Inspiring Cry he can use from any position. Battle Heal, these are locked, I don't have them. Battle Heal, again, he can only use them from the first two positions. Holy Lance, he can only back two positions, but it hits the back two targets, not both of them. And then we've got Dismas, the Apprentice Highwayman, and these are the only two set characters, I believe. Everyone begins the game with Renald and Dismas. And then you'll notice Dismas' preferred position is the two middle spots, but he can kind of work the last and the first position. That's because his pistol shot is usable from any of these three positions. Very back, the middle back, or the back. And that he can hit anybody in their front row. Grape shot hits the first three rows and can be used from the two middle positions. Cracking shot is a buff for himself. It can be any position. Oh no, it buffs him. Oh, they changed this. Oh, I haven't played for a while, guys. This used to be just a self buff, but it's damaging as well. So yeah, he'll, And again, you can see there the dots represented. I think I've explained this enough. But basically, the corpse mechanic, what it does is, normally enemies will slide up in position once someone in front of them has died. But because the corpses are there, they do not slide up, so it's even harder to reach guys in the back row than it came first released. That's why I don't like the core mechanic. It was already a hard game, and they made it harder. Wine, wine, wine. Scum. Oh, there's the next in the preview. I won't spend too much time on the status screen, but I will point out the quirks to you, because this is again another main mechanic of the game. Every unit is kind of unique in that they have quirks, which most of the time they just modify their stats or something like that. Right? He gets plus 10% damage if the torch is above 75, so if you keep the dungeon well lit, he does more damage. I picked up Unyielding during the tutorial, which is cool. He's got 10% resistance to death blows, which makes it his best resistance. 67 base, plus 10% from the quirk. Excuse me, my stomach's upset. You can see all the resistances here to various status effects, and move is, occasionally there will be an enemy with a skill that can push you to the back or pull you to the forward. That's his move resistance. Debuff, I guess, is to debuff. Trap is his, basically, his trap spotting skill. And you'll notice, Dismiss is much better. Yeah. Deathblow, that's another core mechanic, is basically when your heroes run out of HP, when their HP is at zero, they're not dead, they have a status called Death's Door. Which means if they get hit again, there is a chance that they'll die. That's a little bit of forgiveness on the dev's parts, is your guys don't die when they hit zero HP. They go on Death's Door, and then the next hit might kill them. With his death blow at 77%, Renald is one tough motherfucker. He's probably not going down. I say that, but then again, the RNG is pretty unforgiving in this game. 77% leaves a 23% margin. Still a huge margin. And if you're coming into this with the same head that I did, saying, oh, 77%, you know, that's practically guaranteed to succeed. No, you will learn that that 23% is a huge risk factor. Let's see, he's also got God-fearing. That means he'll only pray for stress relief. He'll open up in a minute, but the Abbey, where I'll be doing my praying. Stress is another big mechanic. You'll see that they have a little bit of stress from doing the tutorial. Ooh, I have a little bit of fatigue from doing the tutorial. If their stress reaches 100, they become, what is it called? Stricken? Afflicted. I'm sorry, they become afflicted if their stress reaches. That means they get a very nasty debuff, which basically lowers stats. Crazy shit in combat, like they hurt themselves, they might attack a party member, they might just not listen to you. Basically like in Pokemon, where Pokemon is overleveled and confused at the same time. Sometimes they don't give a shit, and sometimes they do stuff that screws you. But yeah, basic combat strategy. Except once skills can only hurt positions, and they only work from certain positions too, so you want to have guys in the right kind of lineup, right formation, and then the enemy formation also plays a large role in that you can't hit guys in the back until guys in the front, and even if you kill them, they drop corpses, which you then have to deal with, unless you kill them with Light Bleed crit. Then there's the quirks, which, they're exactly what they are, what they say they are. It's what's on the box, guys. It's the quirks add interesting little quirks to your characters, or sometimes provide real stat bonuses, or it's the opposite of a bonus. Might change the color palette. Nah, I like gold-plated, right. As for Dismiss, Dismiss is a black guy. I'm just kidding. But you can have a red scarf to match the same kind of color theme as Renald. Show that they're bros. Camping skills are only used when you make camp in a dungeon, which is only used in medium or long dungeons when you have firewood. I'll get to that when it, you know, we'll cross that bridge when. You can upgrade their equipment. You see my equipment is one right now. But in order to upgrade their equipment, first you have to upgrade the blacksmith. I haven't unlocked. So this is your hamlet. You gotta upgrade the hamlet in order to upgrade your heroes, like I just said. It's also where you deal with stress. They keep stress between missions unless you send them, like, the Abbey, Tavern, Where, you know, they can do some praying or drinking or self-flagellating or flagellating with the help of some prostitutes, you know. Yeah, the tavern offers services as well. Get over it. The graveyard's pretty interesting. It's where you can view your fallen heroes. Because this game just, they rub your past mistakes. Or rub your nose in your past mistakes, really remind women and men, soldiers and is a stagecoach? I'm gonna speed through things because I've been talking too much. Basically, you can upgrade the buildings. I can get a bigger roster. Right now, I can only hold 9 heroes at this time. But I can upgrade to 12. Yeah, wait. Well, I better do that. New resource. Use your basic resources, match the pictures to the symbols, match the symbols and the numbers, the things you want. Oh, I can trade. Yeah, I forgot about that. Huh. Well, that's fine. I didn't have that before. I'm not going to increase the number of available heroes, but I will increase the size of my.
Word is traveling. Ambition is stirring in distant cities. We can use
I'm gonna
this.
Be pretty conservative with the upgrades for right now. I don't really want to stage. This ancestor's
time,
memoirs.
You will know the tragic extent.
Yeah. Don't remind
failings.
Me. I know. Oh, this is just where you cutscene. Oh yeah, you upgrade the hamlet so that you can upgrade your heroes or various different things, like for example, roster, size limit, as well as how many heroes come in on the coach every time you return. If I were to hit this right now, I believe I would get another hero selection available. You can recruit them for free. There's no cost for recruiting heroes, so again, you don't need to worry about it's dying. Are these guys any good? That's the question. I'm not worried about the base stats. It's not like Pokemon IV and all that. I don't think. But what quirks does it have? Virtue. So when their stress reaches 100, rather than become inflicted, they have afflicted. Yeah. They have a chance to become virtuous instead. And what that basically means is their stress has reached a hyper-tense state. Their stress is at 100, and they have a chance to use that to gain a powerful buff. Just like in real life, some people react very negatively to stress, and others sort of rise to the occasion. So whenever your stress hits 100, so a chance that you might be virtuous, which is the exact opposite of becoming afflicted. It gives you a huge buff to almost all of your stats, and I think sometimes they take like double turns or something like that. I'm not sure. It also gets resilient, which is plus 10% stress healed. I should mention there's a difference between E and healing for stress. There, encouragement. One companion minus 15 stress. That's stress healing. It's a 10% bonus when he is healed of his stress or her. If the witch doctor. Witch doctor's kind of cool. Depending on the skill loadout, skill set. Frontline, back row. I prefer to keep mine in the back row. It's in the game. Plague doctors. And it looks like I got my preferred look. Yeah, incision. Incision is what makes them viable. But otherwise, you're basically throwing various different grenades from the back line. Some support stuff. Disorienting blast is shuffle. Yeah, no, I like that. So, yeah. Yeah, disorienting blast is good. Not only does it shuffle a single target and stun them, it also clears all the corpses from the enemy. Let's see. So that's a basic buff. Alpha skills. Battlefield medicine's a... the buff is nice, but I don't really like buffs too much. I would rather have Cure Blight and Bleed. Because those get really... Decision. Yeah, no, I don't really care for Noxious Blast. It's powerful. It can hit the one of the first two targets. And it inflicts a lot of blight. But I prefer to have Plague Grenade, which hits the back two targets. For the same percent chance, and it'll... It hits two targets instead of one, basically. Not to mention, because it keeps you in the back row, it can be paired with Gas, which is stun on both back targets. In setup, fascinated. Whoops. First Plague Doctor. Which again, these are, there is some variation to the first two heroes you can recruit. They are always a Plague Doctor and a Vestal. But there is a little bit of variation with quirks and what skills they have to begin with. But this Witch Doctor, Plague Doctor, it's good. Quick draw is good. 20 strength. Plus 20. It's in the. It's minus accuracy. Now, later on in the game, I fiddle with the quirks a little bit. You can remove negative quirks entirely. I'm not sure if you can remove positive quirks. I know that you can lock them in. Right, that's how it works. You can remove negative quirks at the asylum? Sanitarium. You can remove negative quirks at the sanitarium. Can't remove positive quirks, but you can only have so many quirks until the game starts to overwrite them, basically. If you reach the maximum, if you then get a new quirk, it will rewrite one of your quirks. Sanitarium, in addition to removing negative quirks, will allow you to lock in a positive, meaning that one can. These skills look. Divine Comfort is nice because if multiple party members are on Death's Door, you can get them off Death's Door. Because again, the way. Basically, you don't die when you hit. So if you even have one hit point, you won't die to be put back on the door. Can't be killed. So divine. But I think with things like critical hits and what can be killed outright, you don't have a chance to. Not sure. And then Divine Grace is weak sauce healing. Healing is always in this game, to just, they don't want you to sit there and healings. That would be too good, too forgiving. The idea of this game is to be unforgiving. But once you start upgrading the build, you can upgrade your skills, and then it's viable. They just didn't want it to be viable from the get-go. Dazzling Light's alright. No, I guess that's. No, one as well. All right, so I basically have one skill that I can't use. Once I move Dismiss to the. No, then she won't be used to. Huh. Yeah, I think she's also going back position. If I put her up where she can use a Band of Light, she loses two of her skills. Rather have her have the three skills, have her two skills. Good move. And just not two skills, just one. You're definitely up for it. And of course, positioning is important because enemy target, they'll prefer targets in the front row. Not so much in the back rows, but that doesn't stop range. Actually, screw that. It's not just ranged enemies. It's melee melee-only enemies. Well, enemies, for whatever reason, don't follow the same rules that your heroes do, in that, like, okay, this is very obviously a melee attack, and I can hit the first two rows with it. Enemies do not follow that rule. An enemy can use a melee attack on pretty much anyone in your party. It's complete bullshit. I hate when in games, the enemies don't follow the same rules as you. Like, in Dark Souls, the enemies seem to have infinite stamina. Magic. Anyway, I spent way too much time on the status screens. It's time to, like the game said, there's not much to do in town. So this is your party lineup. Doesn't really matter which position they're in, since they work best in the back two rows. There. Like I said, she's got Hand of Light, but if I move her up to that position, then she's not going to be able to use these two skills. I'm going to ignore the fact that she has Hand of Light. Sorry. I'm not giving the other two skills, so I can use. But I should mention that each of the classes, while they are more or less unique to this game, they do have their role. Like, obviously the Crusader is your frontline, very tanky ward. He's pretty good at dealing damage, just a lot better at taking hits than dealing damage. I shouldn't have to explain the rogue, really. He can't take hits as well as the warrior, but he can deal high damage, especially if he hits. He can also inflict bleeding, so that's cool. Vestal is more like middle between healing support and doing damage. Imagine cleric, but like in the sense of Dungeons and Dragons, where you're sort of a battle priest, let's say. So she is actually a decent frontliner. I just don't have that skill load. If I had Mace Bash, it would be viable. But right now, it's like Illumination would help. Now I'm just already talking. Oh, look, I can go straight to the Darkest Dungeon. It's great. Let's not do that, though. It'll preview rewards later on. There'll be more quests, and you kind of want to pick which one rewards, or the length of the quest, as well as the difficulty of it. But anyway. Before you head out on the quest, you gotta take provisions, which includes food, I forget to take, and torches. And then there's various other things. I usually bring one of each, depending on how it fills out. I highly recommend that you bring at least one of each, because I think... How do I sell them back? Alright, real quick, is that it? Yeah, I highly recommend you bring them, because they're very cheap individually, and even when you get all of them, that's what, was that, about 1,000 gold? 60. Yeah, a little less than 1,000 gold. It looks like 950. I highly recommend you bring at least one of each, because any of these, well, the medicinal herbs and the bandages have they can heal certain status effects, but the skeleton key and the shovel are basically just used to get obstacles. The skeleton key can open various types of chests to greater rewards than just spent on here. I guarantee if you complete the quest, you'll get at least 1,000 gold. Don't worry about the buy-in. If you have one of these, use it correctly, you'll get even more reward. Don't worry about buying. I recommend this one of these. And you don't want to be stuck behind a barricade without a shovel. That's just no fun. You'll see later if I encounter one. I mean, basically, if you run into a barricade, don't have a shovel, everyone in your party going to accrue stress, and I think they take damage as well. It's not good.
Ooh. And I kind of skipped over this in the tutorial.
Too many tutorial messages. I kind of skipped over this in the tutorial, but the environment as you're walking through the dome has various different interactables. I forget what the technical term for.
Trinkets and baubles, paid for in blood.
But some of these interactables, they require a certain item. Happen to use that item, you're, I think you're guaranteed a good result.
The way is
oh, hey, look
lit.
At that.
The path is clear. We require only the strength to follow it.
He gets a damage bonus against undead, so I'm gonna buff him up even more. Make sure that happens. How do I rearrange these? This is terrible. I don't like this.
Executed
oh, yes.
With impunity.
Oh, that's right. They get a
another one falls.
Bonus to resisting stun.
A trifling victory.
Just for free. That's intrinsic to every enemy in the game. Whenever you stun an enemy. When that enemy recovers from stun, they also have this is unlocked, so I don't think if I use my key, there's either effect or reward, but I don't want to. Oh, it looks pretty shovel.
Only the first test. Now it must be carried home.
Sometimes scouting happens, I think it's a percent chance happening. It reveals certain things on your map. Oh, look, a barricade. So nice
Even
of them to give me a shovel for free.
Seems bent on preventing passage.
But yeah, anytime you find a thing to interact with in the dungeon, there's a chance that something horrible will happen. But basically, if you, shit. Well. Basically, if you interact them without using any kind of item, there's a small chance that something will go horribly wrong. But if you do have the correct item, and you use it in the correct way, then there is 0% chance that something horrible will happen. In fact, it will always be a positive result. In addition to that positive result, you usually get some kind of bonus reward. I should also mention that certain quirks will interact with the environment in surprising ways. For example, if you have a character that is a kleptomaniac, I think is the name of the trait. And you come across a treasure item, then they might immediately jump on that, open it up, and then keep whatever they find for themselves. Killing me, Smalls.
The ground quakes.
Hey, yay, yay, yay. Don't touch my lady. My lady
As
touches
the
you.
Falls, a faint hope blossoms.
Oh, there it is. Okay, that's... Yeah, I don't like the way these skills are on. So I wonder if I can change...
Success so clearly in view.
Okay, so there were a lot of things going on. Trick of the light? And I will explain in just a minute. There we go. And change the order of skills. Okay. So you saw a lot of things going on. Like, number one, torch. The amount of light affects various. Combat mechanics, environmental things. You'll see my bright, my torch is very bright right now. Intervals are at 25%. The bar is 100. Each one of these 5. So if it's above 75, it's as bright as it can get. I think the torch adds 25. I don't want to light a new torch yet. But it's very bright, which means my scouting chance is very high. Very high chance of surprising. I notice there's also the option to use the torch or to snuff out the torch entirely. Reason for that, darker, scouting chance goes down, and your chance to get the jump on the enemy goes down. But your chances to get increased loot go up, and enemies have a better chance of surprising you. It's the risk-reward system of the lower light means higher risk, but greater reward. That's it. Plain and simple. And then, what else was that? Oh, you'll see my guys take stress, or gain stress, whenever they take damage. He's quickly fucked, so.
Packs laden with loot.
Yep.
Are often low on supplies.
Renald, I didn't know you were... God, I missed that. He is a kleptomaniac. So I missed out on a torch and I missed out on a key. I'm not sure if this is true, but I believe if I keep him highlighted like this, or if I keep him at the front, he's going to do that like every single time. But if I don't keep him highlighted, then there's less of a chance that he'll do that. Great. Then. Oh yeah, walking around in the dark also increases stress, so it's a good idea to keep him not interested in experience for yourself, but it also means that your rewards will be reduced, so it's your choice, really. There are also certain skills or certain items, bonuses, buffs, stuff like that, that work better in the dark, and the opposite is true as well. There are certain items and certain skills and certain buffs that work better in light. I'll just leave that for you out. But you also notice that when I do well in a battle, my heroes recover from stress, and when I do not so well, or whenever they take hits, I think, they get stressed. No, he doesn't. He's only got a 20%. This is decent. Also notice that the Vestal, she has certain abilities that increase my light level. That's cool. Yeah, see, that's what I'm talking about when melee enemies. He's way back there. He's in the third position. There's no way one of my guys would be able to use a melee attack from the third position and then also hit the enemy's third position. That makes no sense. Enemies just playing up straight. Plane don't follow the same rules as me. Plane, but it is. See, Dismas is in the second row, and if they're third row, I have to use a ranged attack. Like, it's cheating. Uh-huh. resisted. Dang it. Oh, of course I'm bleeding. And I got the debuff. No. Show me Dismas' stats. Yeah, my bleed is 40%. Well, it's twice as much as him, but he didn't bleed. I'm not really complaining. 40% isn't much. Kind of makes sense. Okay, bye, guys. Okay, this kind of chest is what I was talking about. This is an heirloom chest. It doesn't say it's locked. Let's use a key on it and see what happens. He unlocks a hidden compartment.
Awarded to the brave and the foolhardy alike.
Oh, this is a new blood-soaked pages. This dark cave stripped with an overabundance on my threshold of comfort. Dude, you're kind of a wuss if you're bothered by humidity. Understand if it's hot, but I don't. I nearly broke my ankle. Oh, it's slippery now. It's slick with some ubiquitous slime. It will stir and slosh with no visible force, and the shadows beneath the torchlight seem to grow and shrink their own. Wine. This is 17 document. 6 of their story. What's that? Oh, wait, we don't want to skip ahead in the story. Spoilers. Page 4. Same story. Yeah. But this takes up space in my inventory? What the hell? I mean, that's interesting and all, but they better be worth some money when I get back to town or something. Damn. But yeah, during combat, you'll notice a lot of knives flying around that aren't strictly like your damage. There's also stress. I don't want to call it stress damage, but they refer to it as stress healing. Well, why not? Take stress damage, basically. That. Or whenever you get hit by a particular, such as a critical. There are also certain enemies that purely do stress damage, or they have attacks that are particularly stressful. High amount. Curios, that's what they're called. The elements, the environmental interactables. Curios. I don't want to go that way. I only have to explore 90% of it. Just for. Oh, don't you fucking dare. Oh, that's a ton of food. Thank you. Feed my Vestal, then. Food can be used for healing. It's not recommended. Cool. Oh, okay. Not recommended because your adventurers do get hungry every once in a while. Yep, there it is. Hunger. This pops up at random. As far as anyone can tell, it's completely random. It can pop up multiple times in the same hallway. There are certain runs where you will get completely screwed over because the hunger prompt pops up way too fucking. But yeah, food can be used for healing, but it's not recommended because occasionally stop and eat. Oh, goody goody. More. Glad I bought that shovel. So there's stress damage and stress healing, as well as your normal healing and damage. Like I said, certain enemies, this fucker, Bone Courier, certain enemies will do attacks that both damage, that do regular damage as well as stress damage. Some just do heavy stress damage while dealing no damage at all, or only damage. Like I said, particular enemies are set that they are stress inducing, very stressful not as fast as possible. Jesus! Yeah, see, they all took stress because a critical hit was struck against me. Yeah, but you run into too many of these fuckers. You'll see now when he uses Tempting Goblet. Oh, 3 damage. That's not that. Whoa, 20 stress damage. That's a fifth of my bar. It's not cool. But yeah, you run into enough of these guys, or if they just hit the same target enough times, you're gonna have a bad time. So yeah, oh, look at that. Blight persists you corpse. That's interesting. So yeah, take them out with prejudice. Zero damage. Oh yeah, the other thing I wanted to point out is all this stuff at the bottom is actually really helpful. So that's just basically your inventory and map, but you'll notice when I hover over an enemy, it gives me all the info. It's all there. So, as harsh and unforgiving as this is, they're incredibly transparent when it comes to combat details, which is nice. You can even tell, you can't tell the turn order, but you can tell which enemies have and have not acted. There's this little gold tick here indicates that they have not acted yet. I guess bosses might action. Never seen an enemy with action, though. But yeah, it doesn't fully reveal your hit. But yeah, they took this sort of tell-all approach as far as combat information goes, as harsh as the game is. They really want you, like, I guess it's sort of like if you make a mistake, then it's entirely your fault, because here's the readout. I would hover over with my mouse, but basically, there's your bone arbalist. It tells you what type he is. He's unholy. It tells you his dodge and speed. You can get a feel for, obviously dodge determines his chance to dodge, but I'm confused on what to say next, because your hero chance to hit percent, your chance to hit is right next to it there. But I guess it's important to know what his dodge stat is, because there are certain debuffs that will raise and lower. Like, for example, this guy has a dodge of 0. If you have a hard time hitting him, you're not going to want to reduce his speed, or you're not going to want to reduce his dodge, because... Oh, it's a 0 anyway. Okay.
Roommate had made me dinner. Now I got food on my hands. I need to go get a napkin. I'll be back.
Yes, the roommate made me dinner. And they're extremely oily taco things. So I had to run and get a nap. But anyway, I'm sure you've taken a good long look at that status screen now and don't need me to explain anything else. I just think it's interesting from a design perspective that they give you all that information. Like I said, it kind of reinforces the idea that if you make a mistake, that's entirely on you. For example, I complain a lot about my hit chance being 85%, but sometimes the RNG screws me over and says, well, no, you still have a 15% chance to miss. And I'm like, yeah, well, with only a 15% chance, it seems to happen a lot. But yeah, you can even see their various resistances. Like, I'm never going to bleed this undead creature. That should just be common sense, but, you know, it's there on the stat screen to remind you. And, you know, 25% of the time, he might resist my stun. He's not going to be pushed around at all. This guy might be. It shows you your skills, but it doesn't really explain the skills at all. I don't know what's up with that. Well, anyway, back to fighting. These taco things are really good. Guess I'm gonna be mouse only for a while. Keep one hand free. Yeah, he's dead. Blight and bleed, they always proc at the beginning of the turn. So he's dead. He'll take 4 damage from blight as soon as it's his turn. And that'll kill him. Bye bye. They're spicy too. This man knows his stuff. Wapam! Continually onslaught. Destroy them all. So you get things like jade. Like precious gems and stuff. And they just increase the amount of gold that you find. But then you can also find stuff like this. Accessories. And as we all know, accessorizing, very important. So you see, Hellstone, you take just a small hit to your speed stat, no big deal. Especially on a character like Dismas. Who's got a lot of speed. And you get a 10% bonus to your HP. That's great. Same thing with the protection stone. You take a small hit to your speed, and you get a bonus to your protection. Protection is your resistance to damage, I think. Everyone's protection stat is 0%. I'm not sure exactly how protection works. Is some kind of shield, some sort of barrier, like you have to get through your protection points before they can get to your health points? Is that how it is? But yeah, you see things like this armor base, weapon base. Stats come from your weapon and your HP, it's granted, whatever, I shrugged. His HP shrugged. Comes from his armor? So by upgrading his armor, he gets more health points? I don't know. Yeah. Oh, it must be because he's buffed right. Yep, that's it. So yeah, the Plague Doctor and Dismas both could take that minus one to speed. Not have any issues. Nald only has one speed anyhow, so I really don't feel like taking him down to zero be an issue. He doesn't really need that health or protection, though. I'm not sure how protection works exactly, but from the sound of it, I'd imagine it increases your survivability somehow. It's already the Tank Master. Hate to ruin my speediest character's speed stat, but why don't we give them... And you can see equip them straight from spoil screen, which is good, because I can't hit take all right now. I don't have enough. Well, there we go. It's complete. I do want to continue adventure this time. Don't want to miss this chest. These are yours. And I'll then steal them. Thank you.
For a task well performed.
Now I'm going to get the fuck out of here. The reason I skipped the chest in the tutorial was because it's trapped. And it very plainly and obviously tells you that it's trapped and you should not touch it. But, that's how this game... Not gonna talk about the results screen. It is what it is. Oh, I got a dish. Nice. Leaves is possessed by demons. Now minus 20% stress, that's not stress healing. That just means that you will take 20% less stress damage than other people. While the torch is lit. So yeah, you usually, almost always, it's odd that Reynold didn't get any quirks, because you usually almost always get at least one quirk every time you complete a dungeon. Good or bad, sometimes both. See the loading screen, people? The loading screen tips are important.
Interest, yeah. And obsession. Mile markers.
So it keeps the activity log. You'll see how it cataloged that completed the tutorial. These two escorted me. That they reached resolve level 1. Whatever upgrades you bought. Whenever you recruit new people as well as well, actually you recruit. It's weird. But whenever you embark, what the result was, generally, was it a success or a fail? Leveling up. And it also tells you what unlocks are available. Oh, and which week it is, that's important too. I'm gonna now point out my gold amount. I think I had 4,460 gold before provisioning, or before getting the keys and whatnot. All those little doodads. After buying them, I had something like 3,510. Look at how much gold I got off of that quest. I spent an extra 1,000 gold, and I nearly doubled my money anyway. I put that shovel to good use. I put that key to good use. So one could argue, and I most certainly will, that I really only wasted the gold I spent on bandages and the herbs or whatever. Which, looking back, I could have used bandages to speed status on one of the heroes at one point. So was it really a waste of 1,000 gold? I don't think so.
Pleasure. Always visit Code.
Free. Warman and his faithful beast. A bond forged by battle and bloodshed.
It refreshes after every quest. But if you hit the upgrade. Oh, I was wrong. On the next cycle, it will have 3. Increases the number. Higher, the change will take effect after you. Should enough. That's okay. I didn't know this was a thing. I guess that's to save time in case your A team wipes out. You don't have to start all.
Fresh kegs, cards.
Yeah, I know how stressful it is.
Promise solace to the weary and broken alike.
Increase stress recovery.
Endured against the horrors below. The cobwebs have been dusted.
Increase stress recovery. Stress recovery.
Why? Because the base stress recovery is like, I don't know, 20 or something laughable like that. But with the first upgrade, feels like more than half of their stress bar, so like around 50, maybe a little more, I feel like. So that first upgrade definitely works. Nobody's particularly stressed though. I'm pretty much out of resources. I've got the upgrade. Excuse me.
You notice the next batch of upgrades is reduced treatment cost. That's also pretty.
Excuse me.
Cost effective. It'll save you a lot of money. God damn it.
It'll save you a lot of money in the long run. I am less concerned with wasting money on provisions, because it's always better to come prepared than unprepared. Over-prepared is better than... I'm less concerned with spending a ton of money on provisions, and more concerned with getting reduced cost upgrades as soon as possible. Saving money in the long run. Definitely. Better strategy. And like I said, buying more provisions has a... gives the chance of getting better rewards. So you're not really wasting them. So you'll notice that now I have several quests open. This one's short and it's low level. Goal is to complete 100% of room battles, so that's a little tougher than a room exploration. This requires me to fight battles. Room exploration doesn't require you to fight battles. It doesn't even require you to explore all of the rooms. Usually it's 100%. It does offer up the Swordsman's Crest, which is Crusader only, which I think is a pretty good item for, well, just pretty good basic accessory for Crusader. Especially if you don't use healing, it's too much. So I'm very interested in doing this one. But let's see what else. Stunning. Have a great one. Ooh. But I don't have a plan to do it. I might later, though. Shimmering. Plus 8 dodge. Dodge tank rogue, anyone? I think I'm gonna go for it. Oh, it's a medium.
I didn't notice this one's also medium. So again, risk versus reward. It's odd that Holy Lance is a melee skill. The Crusader is a very powerful class to begin with. I think that he's right to be. So I think I'm actually. So you notice that now that I have several quests available to me, they have varying rewards. Different amounts of gold, as well as different. Whatever these are called. Packs, relics. Upgrade material. In varying amounts. And they usually accessory as well. So I usually just pick my quest based on what it has. I really want that cloak. Healing is weak sauce anyway. Excited to, but fuck it, but fuck it. So this is medium quest, which is camping, and camping requires firewood. Automatically, we'll get to camping. When it, usually quests that require camping, they only give you one. Again, they're tactics behind strategy. Because it's medium, I'm gonna take a little bit extra food. I'm also going to take more torches, shovel, anti-venom, bandage, medical skeleton. Oh wait, they already gave me. Yeah, you'll notice that anti-venom cures blights, poisons, and toxins. Bandages bandages cure bleed. Medicinal herbs clear any debuffs. Holy water increases resistances. So they all have a use in combat, but then their out of combat uses, they can be used on various curios to various effects. Anyway, I'm happy with this. Spent about 2,000, I think, on provisions. Can't avoid the cost of food. But you know, I'll earn it back. I'll earn it back plenty. It is getting kind of late, y'all, so I think I'm going to call it a night after this one. Just a word of warning.
The fiends must be driven back. And what better place to begin than the seat of our noble line?
Yeah, whatever. Oh, shit.
Watch your step.
Well, no one told me there was a trap there. How was I supposed to know? I'm just glad Renault's not taking stuff. Heyo! Oh, they're surprised, thank God. He resisted. See if I can't bleed this big fucker out. Oh, he's big. He takes up two spaces. Why are you so fat? A lot of what you saw there was various resistances and skill effects coming into play, such as the move resist I talked about earlier, bleed, stun, other stuff. I didn't know this, but I guess they changed the skill a little bit. Not only does open vein inflict damage as well as bleed, it also inflicts a debuff now, where they become more susceptible to bleed. That's awesome. And then, of course, bleed stacks with itself. Also, I should point out that the quest is to complete 100% of room battles. There are random encounters in the hallways. They are not part of this quest. Can't really help running into them. There's no way to tell. Sometimes you can avoid them if you get a scouting chance. But yeah, just wanted to point out, this does specify room battles. You don't have to worry about any battles that occur in the hallway. You can avoid them if you can. Should avoid them if you can. Or if you want to. Whoa, there we go. Brought him right to the front. I can. But do I want to? Nah, not quite enough. Reynald, you're disappointing me. He did the minimum damage possible. I was hoping to do a little bit more, closer to the maximum, so that the bleed would kill him. I can just leave him alone for now. Bleed will kill him eventually. Nope, didn't stun him. Bandaging. Nah, that's okay. We'll let him bleed. Oh, he's part of the back rows now. He can be bladed. Yes, now he will die. That's why I wanted front row. Okay, bye. Not this way to the sharpened blade. How? Oh, I can hit him. Okay, why not? If you can stun him, stun him. Really can't emphasize that enough. Ding. Blanket fire. Their formation is broken. Maintain the offensive. I take it. Now, like I said before, I can use the skeleton key to unlock a hidden compartment. Get more of a reward. Except there are chests that are actually locked, and I might encounter one of those since this is a medium dungeon, so I'll hold off on using
a handsome reward for a task well performed.
And I'm already plotting out the course I want to beat 100% of room battles, which probably have to check all of this snake. Tracking. Get this one back. Rather do it that way than go straight up. Said there's too much backtrack. I'd have to backtrack through two rooms rather than two holes. With these traps. Why doesn't anyone tell me? Reynald, don't you dare. Oh, Reynald, what are you doing? No, what are you doing?
It was anyway. He's gonna keep the torch. I feel like Saul doesn't keeping it. Oh look, there's nothing in this room. Cool. Oh. Take it. No more trap space. Oh, spiders. That's not good. So now kinda have to shuffle my party around a bit. Hey, that's okay. Right. Just glad it didn't do any damage. Do your thing. So yeah, if you know the speed of your own party members, so you can kind of figure out who's going first. But the problem with that is you don't know the speed of your enemies. Yes, you do. Okay, so you can roughly figure out turn order then. Speed is directly related to turn order. A higher speed will make you move first. There is no random element involved. Basically, my Plague Doctor has a speed of 7. Dismas has, he normally has 5. My Vestal has 4, and my Crusader has 1. So they will always move in that order. No random element. Same with the enemy. Because the enemy's speed is 5, they will always act 1 priority 5. So the larger turn order should go my Witch Doctor, Dismas, Spider, Vestal, Crusader. I think. There might be a coin toss if they're tied, because Dismas normally has 5 speed. I don't know.
Back to the pit. A trifling victory, but a victory nonetheless.
Oh wait. There you go. Ah, the torch. That's right. I didn't get to use Vestal's attack skill. Huh. I wonder how many room battles there are. What's this? See, it's locked. There you go. Now I definitely want to. Yep. Dun dun dun. Too low. Making me nervous.
Oh, joy of joys, giant maggot.
Swiftness with a spin, plug it in, plug it in. Oh. Okay.
Ringing ears.
What? What is happening right now, chat? What are we doing? What grievous injury! He took 3 points of damage, guys, chill. If I get lucky, that'll kill both of them. One of them, that's still good. And now that I think of it, I should buff him first because it gives him more speed and he's a slow ass. Grape shot? 3-6. Oh my god, no wonder he missed. The hit chance is 80% and 65%. Let's not do that actually. 70%. Yeah, the difference between pistol shot and open vein is pistol shot has a higher crit chance but does less damage. Open vein does more damage. It also has a chance to bleed and do that debuff. Makes them susceptible.
So more consistent damage, higher crit chance. Oh, this also does more damage against marked targets. I didn't realize. Higher consistent damage bleeds. So this is almost always better, unless you can't hit them, in which case it's your pistol shot. Ugh, but then he'll dodge entirely, because why not? Just do that again. There you go. Oh, and I got a key back. That's cool. What's the light like? Oh, the light's bad. Huh. Nah, I can basically... Well, I can't basically stun lock. Well, I can't bleed these guys, so maybe it's better. Damn it. Rolled minimum damage. Quarrel. I know what it means. It refers to the ammunition he's using, but I always think of it as, the word quarrel, which means, to fight. To argue with. Like, they had a quarrel. Anyway. Damn it!
Play grenade. I hope you all like blight.
Oh wait, they're corpses. They hate light. I'm gonna get started on that back row. What's your speed? One. Ride with Renald. Oh no, he's buffed right now, so he's actually kind of fast. Okay, I should probably get the accuracy bonus. Damn. Yeah, Crusader can do some heavy damage against undead. Or unholy. I'm sorry, not undead. Yeah, now he's at Death's Door. I forgot. Death's Door gives you huge stat penalties. It's until the end of the quest. Heyo. So even with the stun resist buff, there's a small chance that he will still get stunned. And I want to keep my light level high, so there's that. God damn it! I need to keep people off Death's Door. Those stat penalties stay until the end of the quest, and this is a medium quest. No. Oh god. Oh wait, Renald can't hit the back row. It's a problem. I just have to force my way through, I guess. Or we can do like this. Bye-bye, corpses. Yeah, you'll see that the penalties from Death's Door, they last until the end of quest. Even if you heal them up off of Death's Door, they still have all this bullshit to deal with. I think while camping, there are certain skills that will remove Death's Door penalties. Yeah, there it is. Stand tall. Remove mortality debuffs. So that's great. I'm gonna need that. I can only use it on one of them. Oh, damn it. Oh, I have them. Oh wait, self only? Oh no, all companions. Okay, all companions. I see. So, this is used on the self.
But it also has an effect on the whole party, where if they have the mortality debuff, it... Oh no, it doesn't remove. Ah, oh, damn it! Damn it! I know Dismas doesn't have it. Damn it!
As the fiend falls,
I should have been more careful. Oh, snap. Dump all of the food! Where the fuck? Better than that. Damn it. I guess I should have used those bandages when I had the chance. Oh, it's trapped. So yeah, you see, there's sometimes a chance that, something bad will happen. If I'd used the key, that definitely would not have happened. Yeah, let's, move on. Well, there's a battle inside this. Actually, it's probably better to camp. Okay, so while camping, first, you choose how much food to give your heroes. That will determine how much HP and stress they heal. If you don't feed them at all, they take damage as well as stress. But yeah, basically, I'm gonna give them a feast. That way, if the hunger prompt shows up, I still have 4 food to make sure that they don't starve to death. And that way, I get the maximum healing bonuses. Yay. Now I want Renald to tell Dismas to stand strong, stand tall. Because I don't need those mortality debuffs. Ah shit, I should've used her sanctuary. Dumbass. Making little mistakes all over the place that are gonna cost me. And then I only have so much time left. That doesn't count down at all until you use a skill. Each skill you see has a time cost. Let's see. Nobody's particularly. So I'm not. Healing is good, but I'm not. Healing received. It's because healing is so weak. I should have given Sanctuary to both Dismas and Plague Doc. Been so quick. But, basically, I'm going to Sanctuary. Done that. That's some big healing. God damn it, I should have done that first. And then I want Renault, or I want Dismas at his best, so I'm going to have guns. Just 4. And then we rest. You get a little bit of flavor from each of them, a little bit of dialogue, a little bit, little quips going on there.
Yeah. Which is always nice. Gives your character some personality.
In radiance, may we find victory.
In radiance. Ah, shit. I, probably don't want to run into this battle. But oh well. Grape shot? Oh no, I got. Oh no, the hit percentage is pretty good since he's buffed up. But it's not going to do enough damage to actually kill any one of them, so... Damn!
Give them no quarter.
That crit. Oh yeah, they're 100% resistant to stun. I don't know why maggots are 100% resistant to stun, but...
A blazing star is born.
I love turning the Crusader and I love making the Crusader extra speedy. Speed creep. Creed for speed. Speed Seder. Make him extra speedy. That's okay. Actually, I think I have something new. Spent it. Damn! Never stop critting. It's just a 5% increase. As victories mount, so too will resistance. That's just plus 5% crit on ranged skills. It's not even on melee skills. Okay. Not complaining. Anti-venom now! I don't have any. Oh. Stop being a little bitch. Damn right you're moving. Whoa. Oh, he's another one of those stress-dealing enemies. Wasn't that bad. Oh, wait. What the sh- plus 10% stress until camp? Already camped, though. That is not okay. Stop being crazy. Shit. He's got high protection. I guess that means he resists physical damage? I don't know. Ah, not good enough. Whew. I certainly don't want to go back on Death's Door. I just got off. By the way, I finished eating a while ago, but I'm still keeping free. Bazinga! Isn't that critical? Well, it still gives him stress healing, so okay, I'll take it. 3 and 4. The grape shot deal. 4, 3 to 5. I'm not confident in the hit percent on the madman, but we'll see. Nicely done, Dismas. Nicely done. Would be enough to stun him. Yes, it is. Get smitey! Creed for speed. Yeah, they're all dying. It's cute. Oh god. Ah! A hand's breath from becoming unwound. Doesn't matter on the next turn anyway. Smite. Oh, and I'd also like to point out that, rounds, you'll notice that, this one buff is measured in battles, and the other buff is measured in rounds. Rounds are still kept track of, they're still measured, when in those hallways. You'll notice that the hallway is divided into 4 segments. That's so that there's, you know, 4 chances, obstacle, to appear. Or trap. But those 4 segments also represent 4 rounds. So you will lose the buff before I next reach the next room, but at least for these first 3 segments of the hall, he will have buffs. Going into this battle, I have all active. I don't want to checking. I think if I use medicinal herb. maybe I can just open it.
Wealth beyond measure.
Ugh, I don't.
Awarded to the brave and the foolhardy alike.
Hey, snippet. Oh yeah, I forgot to check what happened to those pages. Read anyway.
Journal of Darius, Highwayman. Day 4. Road to this damned hamlet was a tricky one. Travel. Field its roots. I swore I had seen such neglect. It's collapsed and it's fidgeting uselessly. Swiftly to the tavern. Similar interests had gathered there and assembled.
Okay, thanks, Darius. I don't really need these torches anymore.
Just kidding.
I guess I'll throw off the bandages. Oh, spiders. They're surprised. And Dismas has all of his buff. How about more buffs? Fuck yes. Oh, so there is some explanation on the skills, okay. Only 60%. Ooh, that crit healing. That's really the only time healing is useful is when it scores a critical hit. Well, when you've got 37% bonus damage, I mean. There we go. Dang it. Oh my god, I need more room for gold.
Low and driven into the mud.
No, I hit escape. I didn't know that happened. Yeah, here's an explanation on basically all of the term stats and what objects do. Okay. Oh, there's protect. Okay, let's protect. Or for protection indicates what percentage of incoming damage mitigated. Damage over time's protection. Oh, okay. So protection is just percent damage reduction? That's awesome. Crazy. I don't know. But those journal pages aren't necessary that I'm going to discover. Take it back. Oh, I don't have to worry about it. No more choice. Let's see. Accusing medicinal art or something. Oh. Okay. I don't know how that works. Yeah. I have plenty of torches, so let's burn. Let's light one up and burn it real slow. The confession booth has an additional effect on religious characters, I think, which could be good or bad. Let's send Dismas in there. Make him confess all of sins and stealing. Does holy water have any effect? I can use torches. Can use a shovel. Let's see if holy water has it. It does. Oh, I didn't know that. Interesting. Confession booths are weird though. Sometimes they'll remove a negative quirk, sometimes they'll inflict a positive quirk. That's like, oh, your hero has come to face all of his previous sins. Like he is overcome by his own guilt, and somehow that gives him some sort of... But yeah, it looks like it's a fixed thing. If you use holy water, it'll do massive stress healing. The only thing I have a problem with that, the only reason I have a problem with that is, like I said, there's that slim chance you can get a positive quirk out of it.
Even the cold stone seems bent on preventing passage.
And even though that's just random chance,
I still would like to have that chance. Sometimes the RNG is good. Most of the time, it's not. But sometimes. Sometimes. Why do I have this bad feeling like I'm gonna go all the way back to get that battle? Hey, look at that. Don't you dare, Renald. No, you're looking at it. See you. That box with lusty ass. First test.
Now it must be carried home.
Got torch burn. Hey, look at that. Hey, they surprised anyway. That's the only thing I was worried about going in with less than the maximum light level. Stunned for days. Nicely done, nicely done. Papers? Oh wait, I can hit. Everybody stunned.
Best.
Bleed him out. Doing it. Yeah, let's do that. Oh, they both resisted it? Oh, damn. On only a 20%, too. How does that happen? Bleed him, bleed him, bleed him, bleed him. Doubling up on the bleed. Ow. Well, he doesn't have the stun resist buff, so... Ah, he's still resisted. It's because his base is pretty good. Let's try and whack him. Yes, nice! Okay, so he'll bleed to death. And he won't leave a fat corpse either. Oh man, the one that dodged and the other resisted. Oh man... Yeah, shut up, Renald.
No, he's done. Go to crit 20%? How? Oh, this has a high crit chance. No, wait. It's 10%. This is 5%. Does he have a base of 10? Or a base 5? Yeah, his weapon base is 5%. He's got plus 10 from the skill and then plus 5 from the camp. Does this also increase crit? It does. 5%. No wonder he was critting. Damn! Nice. Oh, a 20% crit chance. That's scoff at. Pretty much full again.
The bigger the beast, the greater the glory.
Smitey. Take off.
Remind yourself that
overconfidence
is a slow and insidious killer.
That not the last room battle. You know what that means. We got a lot of backtracking to
do. I'm gonna go grab these curios, because why not? I've got plenty of Could go. Hey, look, another. Hey, there's a trap. A curio. What? You didn't tell me there was a fight here. Hold on. Doesn't have any. Still better to stun. No? Would you kinda? Alright. I'm oddly okay with this. I can start on. Damn. Even though he's only got that 5%, right? Yeah, let's see. 85% chance to hit 6 to 12, so I need to roll high for the damage. Oh my god, Renan! You're killing me! Oh boy. Ow. Ah, shit. Shit. Got those mortality debuffs again. Hold high on the healing. They do not. Still better to stun. Oh my god! This dude with the critical hits though, seriously, come on. Oh my god, what are you doing? Ismus, please. Resisted it. Yeah. Make him dead. He's going down. He's not going down. That bait. Crit healing. Whack. Whack. No, they don't bleed. Still does go. It still does more damage. Try for the stun anyway. Or no, what I should have done was doubled up on the blight so it would have killed. Oh. 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 That's where the last room is. Recognize the curio symbol. It's just a curio battle. Gotcha. Huh. Only want to open. Locked. Didn't have a key. A lot of gold. Take it. Party's pretty beat. I can sneak that curio. I don't care that the light's getting low. I got torches to burn. Yeah, each torch gives exactly. Nothing confusing there. Or each torch gives exactly 25. Oh, I forgot about hunger. No. Yep.
The walls close in.
Now she's crazy. Yeah, this is what afflicted does. Health. From death. And damage. Good thing she kind of damaged you. Still. It's also paranoid, which. I don't know what that means. Probably terrible. Yeah, I forgot about food.
Injury and despondence set the stage for heroism or cowardice.
I forgot about hunger. I just want that one last curio. Bookshelf. Bookshelf. Torch? No effect. The knowledge within forever changes the hero. Oh, totally worth it. That plus 5 dodge from evasive. Sir. Yes, sir. So I'll look to the glossary for help on this one, but accuracy, short for accuracy, base chance to hit is accuracy minus the enemy's dodge. And from dodge, dodge gets removed from the enemy's accuracy, determine base chance to hit. Yes. So accuracy is affected by accuracy. Mod. Which looks like the base is having that 15 dodge. Oh my god. That's minus 15% chance to hit for the enemies. That is fantastic. Oh, and he's getting the cape. Oh, and he's getting the cape. Oh, he's getting the cape. Oh my god. Totally worth it. What's this effect again? This effect's dodge. Oh my god. That is great. I got an achievable? No, I just got, what was it called? A collection of treasured antiques. Collect at least 30 heirlooms from a single quest. Holy balls. Automatonophobia? That's fear of people? Really? It just be like homophobia? Whoops, no, that's something completely different. Natural eye, plus 5 accuracy range skills. Man, Dismas is just winning at life with these quirks, man. Warren Scrown. It's not a stout. This bothers me. Alright, so note to future self. Try to avoid Death's Door early in the quest, especially if it's a medium or long quest. I fear his long-standing
duties here. Over time, some negative quirks will lock into place and become severe. Severe negative quirks cost much more to remove.
Okay, so that sucks. Negative quirks can also be locked in. The good news is they can be removed as normal just for an increased cost. Oh yeah, there's God. I don't really mind it. It makes stress management a little more difficult, but I don't really mind it. Kleptomania is much more. So yeah, I can still, I'll go to the sanitarium now to show you.
Oh, it's not unlocked. But basically at the sanitarium, you can treat these quirks. You can either lock a positive one into place, or you can remove the quirk. And like I said, it's not like you need to treat a locked in negative quirk twice. It just costs a lot more. So next, his demon is not allowed to gamble. But yeah, plus 15 stun resist at plus two speed. Less stress while the torch is lit. Anyway. Yeah, plus 15% stun resist, plus 2 speed, plus 5 dodge, and plus 5 accuracy to his skills. Yeah, Dismas is turning into quite the awesome character. Yeah, I'm gonna take that off and replace it with the Shimmering Cloak, plus 8 dodge. His dodge is now 23%. That is serious business. We're in the business of dodging things. Who needs disease resist? This is only 30, 50. Yeah, that's because you're afflicted, though. Oh, I see. Affliction lowers all your resistances. That kind of makes sense, since it's like your tolerances are exceptional. But it also affects your stats. I really need to get rid of that. The yips. That's the worst. Any kind of disease type quirk, you know, a negative quirk that's named after a disease, like the yips or like lockjaw or I don't know, whatever. They always have stat penalty. Try to remove as soon as possible, like plus 20% stress in the cove. I could give less of a shit, or couldn't give. But the yips minus 5 accuracy, that will always be bad news in any. Luckily, she's a healer, not a damaged. And the way you get rid of afflicted is you just send them for stress relief. I think. Maybe it's a special thing in the sanitarium. Pretty sure it's stress relief. Their accessories. Plus 20%. Oh yeah, who has the lowest disease resist? 30. Yeah, I'm guessing everybody has 30 except for the plague doctor. And what's the trade-off? Minus 2 dot. You've got decent. Might give it to you. Hate to ruin a good dodge, but what does disease even do? I'm tempted to give it to Renald because that five dodge isn't really going to help. And I would say dodge is like a percentage, but it's opposed by your opponent's accuracy, so it's kind of an set percentage. I'm very tired. I'm gonna wrap this up. I'll decide who gets the disease charm later. And as for the protection stone, I think I'm just gonna give that to. Wait a minute. Her affliction is increasing her speed and her dodge? Huh? I mean, overall, it's definitely very, very good.
But that's interesting. I didn't know affliction give you stat bonuses as well. So that ties in nicely with the flavor of this affliction. But yeah, I think very tight. Next time I stream Dankest Dungeons, be ready to see the Hundmeister and the Arbalist embarking in the Warrens. Or is it the Wailed? I think I've unlocked. Yeah, we'll go to the Wailed next time. The Hundmeister. I would bring her as well, but she's incredibly strong. No, don't provision. Go back. We got the guild where you can upgrade skills. You need to buy the upgrade before you can upgrade. And that's how it works. Let me just.
Some may fall, but their knowledge lives on.
Unlock new skills. It's very expensive though. And the same over here.
The bellows blast once again.
Yeah.
The forge stands ready to make weapons of war.
I don't have a lot of papers though. I need more papers. Oh, and I need more crests.
Busts. Because I'm 7. It means boobies.
I can trade these around, but there's no way I'm gonna get enough to afford. Like, this gives me more crests, but I need both crests and pick. I need like 20. Yeah, that's nowhere near. It's nice how they each have a different exchange rate. They always give you the most of the crests, but it looks like they have individually, they have a secondary, tertiary one as well. Yeah, even if I traded in all since I wanted. Oh no, I can only. I only get to pick one. See, that is much less fair. Okay. What was that thing? That's the great. Instructor, master, two smithing. What is instructor? Oh, I see. I see how it is, stagecoach. I see how it is. Hoot hoot. Found Moshta.
A lawman and his faithful beast. A bond forged by battle.
Sort by class, sort by source. Yeah, I'll manage stress and all that when I get back. I'm gonna go. I got nothing to do. But I'm real sleepy. I would, but I want to save them. Smithing. I gotta go. I gotta go. So wait, what's the dilly with those? Alright. It's been fun. Everybody enjoy your weekend. Happy. Saturday night.